The headstones and epitaphs in a graveyard will tell you a lot about the history of a town. It's no surprise then to find that here in Waihi Cemetery, there are frequent memorials to men killed in cave-ins or mine accidents. This was, and still is, gold mining territory. But I also discovered a headstone here with a much more unexpected past, about an event that I knew nothing of, about a deed much darker than any mine shaft. In fond memory of our Kelvin, the dearly loved fourth son of T.H. and M. McLean, killed in the Waikino School Tragedy, 19th of October, 1923. Oh, memories. And there's another grave just over here to the memory of another little boy killed in the Waikino School Tragedy, the same date. I know that Waikino is a small town just down the road, a few miles out of Waihi, but what was this tragedy that killed two small boys there on the 19th of October, 1923? The most obvious place to start was the Waikino School. I talked to Headmaster Neil Robinson. He says there was some kind of massacre at the school in the 1920s, before his time, and to try Ron Buster.
A lot of the buildings, of course, have disappeared over the years.
Yeah.
There's not much left of old Waikino these days, just a lonely pub on the main road. But when Ron was growing up here during the 20s, several thousand people lived here, and life revolved around the battery which processed the gold from the Waihi mine. The locals sent their children to the old Waikino school, which was on this hill above the township. As I walk with Ron through what was once the old playground, he begins to tell me the story of the tragedy.
I was too young to have been there on the day, but my two brothers were there and my father was there. And over the years in the family discussions, this has been talked over.
Appalling crime, maniac in a school, wild shots with pistol, two children killed, master's heroic action. I settle down to read Ron's scrapbook with a sense of foreboding. It's Friday morning, 19th of October, 1923. The 140 children of the Waikino School are busy with their lessons. The headmaster, Mr. Reed, is next door in his study when he sees a man outside in the schoolyard. The man says he wants to talk to Reed, and so he's invited in. The headmaster recognizes him as a local, one John Higgins. Once inside, Higgins informs the headmaster that he is here for revenge. Higgins says he's been persecuted for 15 years by his neighbors. He says he's thought about it and he's going to shoot some of the children. But he says he respects Reed and asks him to leave before he starts. But Reed tells Higgins that if he's going to shoot the children, he's going to have to shoot him first. Higgins responds with the words, "You won't go? Then you'll have to take it then." Reed's wound means he's unable to speak or call out. Next door, children continue their lessons, unaware of the danger. One small boy, Kelvin McLean, recognizes Higgins and he appeals to him. He says, "Don't shoot me, Mr. Higgins. I never did you any harm." Another boy, Charles Stewart, is also shot dead. Four other children are wounded, among them, Alex Bustard.
My brother was running out the door at one end of the schoolroom, and Higgins came in the door at the other end and fired at random. The bullet went through his stomach. With this terrible wound, he ran a mile down the track from the school into the main township of Waikino and collapsed.
The town is alerted. There's a maniac at the school. Help is on the way, but inside the schoolhouse, the killer is still prowling about, looking for children. But apart from two small bodies, the classrooms are empty. Everyone is outside, hiding. Suddenly, one of the boys sprints back towards the school. Horrified, teachers yell at him to stop. He ignores them. At the door of the school, he darts in. Then he reappears and comes sprinting back, carrying a small package. It's his lunch. Higgins didn't notice the boy because he'd returned to the headmaster's study, where Reed was still alive but barely conscious. Higgins took one look at him and pronounced him done for. He then made the decision to burn the body. He proceeded to gather paper and pile it around of and on top of the wounded headmaster. Police from Waihi and men from the nearby battery, some of them armed, are making their way towards the schoolhouse. When the first men arrive, Higgins yells at them, "What the hell do you want?" And he fires at them. The miners dive for cover, and one of them shoots back. The men are incensed, but they're cautious because they know that Higgins has a reputation for being a crack shot. One of the Waihi policemen, Constable Olson, is hit. Finally, the standoff is ended when the police manage to break down the back door. Higgins gives himself up without a struggle. But the enraged locals burst in and attack him, and the police are forced to come to his rescue. He's handcuffed and he's placed under arrest. A battered and bandaged Higgins is brought out into the open. Local feeling runs so high that it's not considered safe to keep him in the area, and he's immediately taken to Auckland. The press arrive, and soon the whole country knows of the tragedy in the small rural school. The wounded children are taken to hospital, where they become national celebrities. And the two little boys are buried in a huge funeral in Waihi. Constable Olson recovered, as did the headmaster, Mr. Reed, although he never taught again. 4 months later, Higgins was tried for the murder of the two boys here at the Auckland Supreme Court. It was an incredibly harrowing trial. And it so affected the young Crown Solicitor Vincent Meredith that he recalled it 40 years later in his memoirs. Muffled sobs broke out in the women's gallery and started a wave of sobbing throughout the court. Nothing could be done about it, and I continued for the next half hour to conclude my address to the accompaniment of continuous veiled sobs at the back of the courtroom. It took the jury just 70 minutes to reach a verdict of guilty. He was given the death sentence, which was later commuted to life. I couldn't help but think of the Dunblane school massacre. How could any man turn a gun on children? During the trial, there had been some discussion about Higgins' motives, but nothing was ever resolved. I managed to track down John Higgins' own son, and although he didn't wish to appear on camera, he did agree to fill in some missing details about his father's life. John Higgins was a farmer, but times were hard, so he sold firewood to support his family. So why did he do it? Why did he take a gun to the school that day and shoot those children? His son told me something that might explain it. 15 years earlier, John Higgins had suffered a severe head injury in a mining explosion. It changed him. From that day on, he became moody, withdrawn, suspicious of his neighbours. The morning of the tragedy, he'd found one of his horses dead. Convinced his neighbours were responsible, he must have snapped. He took his World War I Mauser and set out for the school, intent on revenge. John Higgins was sent not to jail, but to the Avondale Asylum. His son remembers visiting him in hospital. He says his father never spoke of the tragedy and seemed normal. He died in the asylum in 1928. How does a small community react to a tragedy like this? Despair? Hate? Higgins' son told me a story that says a lot. His mother received a visitor after the incident, Mrs. McLean, the mother of one of the dead boys. She hadn't come to condemn, but to sympathize. He said he'll never forget the sight of the two women with their arms around each other, crying. Higgins' son also told me that as a youngster growing up in the community, no one ever said a bad word to him. But the community did need to forget. Within days, the schoolhouse was burnt to the ground, a common response to such acts of madness. They wiped the slate clean of any reminder of that sad day and got on with building a new schoolhouse and a new future. One of the most unusual graves in Dunedin Cemetery is that of James Balfour. Only 38 years old, Balfour was a marine engineer who drowned off Timaru in 1869. An impressive stone lighthouse stands on each side of this finely carved monument, and at the center, the remnants of what appears to be a small ship. In the grave next to Balfour is another young man of the same age, Thomas Patterson. He also drowned, and coincidentally, it was just 3 days earlier. Thou carriest them away as with a flood. It wasn't unusual that Balfour and Patterson had both drowned. Shipwrecks were common. By 1860, there had been 500 on New Zealand's hazardous coastline. There was a shortage of safe harbours, and travellers were rowed out through often dangerous surf to reach their ships. Another 1,000 people had drowned in rivers, and hundreds of others simply disappeared, presumed drowned. So who were these two Scotsmen lying side by side in the Dunedin Cemetery? Perhaps they knew each other. After digging around in the records, I discovered my hunch was right. They were friends. I found a lot of information about their achievements. Also a photograph of a gentleman standing in front of one of Patterson's tunnels. I wondered if it was him. But there is a photograph that is definitely Balfour. Balfour was related to the famous author Robert Louis Stevenson and to the Stevensons of Edinburgh who designed and built lighthouses. Balfour and Patterson were in fact lifelong friends. They studied engineering together in Edinburgh and both knew the shape their careers would take. Patterson would build roads and railways. Balfour would design harbours and lighthouses. Their ambitions would take them to the other side of the world and pit their talents against the forces of nature. They would succeed in leaving their imprint on this landscape, but they would both pay the ultimate price. A couple of hours' drive south of Dunedin is Nugget Point. This is the site of one of Balfour's most impressive lighthouses. It must have been the dream of every young engineer to tackle an untamed landscape like this. And in 1863, the Otago Provincial Government offered Balfour and Patterson just that opportunity. Their mission was to bridge the rivers and light the headlands. It was a monumental task, and they had the knowledge and the passion to do it. Balfour was just 32 years old when he and his wife arrived in Dunedin to muddy streets and the sounds of a city under construction. His friend Patterson had taken an earlier ship and was already advising on the comparative advantages of road, rail, and trams for the new city. Balfour was keen to get started, He wasted no time taking up the challenge the new land offered him. Within days, he was drawing up preliminary plans for a string of lighthouses along the southern route to Port Chalmers. Next, Balfour turned his attention to surveying the Clutha River and the Molino and Waikawa harbours for shipping access. In his clear and precise manner, Balfour completed all of these tasks within 6 months of his arrival. Designing a dry dock for Port Chalmers was his next challenge. He came up with a revolutionary new design. It was the first of its kind. Meanwhile, Patterson was busy too, opening up the hinterland with new roads and tunnels. By 1864, he'd been made chief railway engineer for the whole of the Otago region. The shortage of excavation machinery wasn't allowed to slow progress. Every cutting and tunnel had to be dug by hand, like this one just north of Orwaka. The Tyree Gorge Railway is probably Patterson's most famous memorial. It runs out of Dunedin for 77 kilometres through spectacular countryside. It was here that Patterson most boldly displayed his engineering skills, using stone and steel construction techniques that he'd learnt in Scotland. His friend Balfour was also a driven man. Balfour's restless mind was constantly seeking to solve problems. By 1867, he was looking for new ways to speed up the construction of the region's badly needed lighthouses. Having them cast in iron and sent out from Scotland was taking too long. So Balfour came up with the radical new idea of using a wooden construction. The first wooden tower he built was at Farewell Spit. With its success, Balfour went on to design Bean Rock in Auckland and other wooden towers. By 1868, Balfour and his friend Patterson had been in New Zealand only 5 years, and their list of achievements was mounting fast. But in their rush to tame the landscape, were they underestimating the power of the forces of nature? In 1869, Balfour submitted a report to the government pointing out the serious dangers to settlers. There were two, he said, needed immediate attention. Bridges were desperately needed to get travellers across hazardous rivers, and not enough safe harbours meant passengers were still being forced to board ships by surfboat. He ended his report saying, "I know too well how these things go. Nothing will be done to meet the dangers that Mr. Patterson and his department and I in mine have pointed out to you till some accident occurs and public alarm is roused by the loss of valuable lives." Balfour had no idea how prophetic his words would prove to be. That very year, he was in Timaru observing a new breakwater when awful news came. His friend Patterson had been returning to Dunedin with plans for a bridge when his coach came to a swollen river. The driver shouted to some men on the opposite bank, asking if the river was safe to cross, but their replies were drowned out by the roar of the rapids. They made a fatal decision. They attempted a crossing. Halfway, they panicked, tried to turn back, and were swept away by the current. Patterson was drowned, caught beneath the spokes of the wagon wheel. Back in Timaru, a grief-stricken Balfour awaited the arrival of the steamship Maori to take him to Dunedin in time for his friend's funeral. The ship anchored offshore in a heavy swell, waiting for passengers to be boarded by surfboat. But the swell was so big that it was deemed too dangerous for the boat to be launched. Balfour was desperate to get to his friend's funeral and insisted on hiring his own surfboat. But as he was being rowed out through the waves, the boat was suddenly capsized. Everyone swam towards the ship, but Balfour was not a strong swimmer. And as he struggled to get closer, the crew threw him a line. But Balfour was tiring in the icy water. His freezing hands couldn't grip the rope, and it slipped through his fingers. The rope was thrown to him again, the crew shouting at him to tie it around his waist. But weak from exhaustion, he seemed not to understand. Finally, with the passing of a huge wave, Balfour was gone. Balfour's body was found on the beach several days later and taken to Dunedin for burial. News of the deaths was received in Wellington with dismay. All over the city, flags were flown at half-mast. The new colony had lost two brilliant men. In just 6 years, Patterson and his friend Balfour had achieved more than most dream of in a lifetime. But their task had been an epic one, perhaps destined to exact a high price. The forces of nature had the final word. Thou carriest them away as with a flood. If you know of an interesting epitaph, write to me at Box 67028, Mount Eden, Auckland.